Ladies and gentlemen, we're speaking to you from the Museum of Natural History in downtown Washington, where we are attending a special guided tour through the torture chamber section, featuring various systems of torture that have been used down through the centuries. The curator of the museum is personally conducting our tour, and he's coming over to our
microphone. My friends, if you'll step right this way, please. We're going to show you some of the methods of torture that have been used down through the ages. Now, this one here, this was used back in the Middle Ages. A system known as the water system, where a man was put into a dark, damp dungeon and a drop of water would fall on his head, a drop at a time, hour after hour, day after day, week after week. You could see that water trickling down there, and finally it would drive the man out of his mind. Now, over here is another technique which was used during the Renaissance period. This is sort of a waffle iron affair. But they would take a man's hand, lay it down under the grill of the waffle iron, and then they would slam the lid shut, like that. You can see how that might have smarted on a man's hand. And over here, of course, is the well-known rack, where a man was laid on a rack, his arms and legs stretched beyond any description or belief. This was an awful method of torture. You can see that rack right there. And so torture has changed down through the ages, but it's still very much in use today.
Excuse me, Mr. Curator.
Yes, sir.
Notice over here in this modern section, there's a little box of some sort. What is this little... It's a small box. What is this?
This, my friend, is the most scientific, cruel method of torture known to man today.
Mm-hmm.
This is a small transistor radio, and would you believe it? We have lost three night watchmen.
Three night watchmen?
Three night watchmen. This radio was left on by mistake to the Joy Boys show at 7:05.
The Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro. We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
The Joy Boys show for Wednesday evening. This is Ed Walker, and Willard Scott is here.
Yesterday, our friend the president took over for us while we were on vacation for a day. We want
to
thank
him
very much.
Covering for us.
A little hand there. Thank you, Mr. President. Bobby Shetton, our recording super. Bobby, on lunch hour already,
huh? What happened? He just ate his lunch.
Big nothing show here tonight.
There's Arthur Q. Page, one of America's finest engineers, and we...
Thanks.
Glad to have him aboard tonight.
It's true.
Coming up on our program, Edward, would you like to tell the
folks? We have Randolph W. Goon and a few interesting poems.
Also on the program, we're going to talk to a man who buys a new car every 6 months. A man who loves new cars and has some interesting things to tell us about buying a new car.
All that coming up in just a few moments. First of all, I see we have something from the Public Service Bulletin Board.
We want to thank Mr. Howard C. Martin of Davidsonville for sending us a very charming public service announcement. The Democratic Doodlers Divertissement Club of Davidsonville is having a drive for deserving Democrats who desire to become ding-dong doodlers. The development devises of doodling doldrums and are doleful and less dogmatic. Don Juans and Don Quixotes are not welcome.
Don't say. Once again, all over America, men are coming home from the offices to be greeted by their wives and little children, ready to settle down for a quiet evening at home, possibly with a good book, or possibly to meditate with poetic words, offered for you this evening once more as we bring you Goon River Anthology, being conducted by that noted poet, Randolph
W. Goon.
I'm a ding-dong daddy from tomorrow.
Mr. Goon is brought to you every week at this time in the hope that you will enjoy quietude and the spoken word. And now Mr. Goon walking into the...
Oh, darn! Big Newton!
Mr. Goon tripping into the studio with his poems in hand.
Thanks to you.
Once more to offer you words to live by.
Economy wave is getting ridiculous. They got the night supervisor doing all the cleaning.
Mr. Goon's first poem for this evening is entitled One Day Old Coco.
Thank you, Mr. Noucher, and good evening.
Please, Mr. Goon.
I've had a heck of a virus during the last couple of weeks.
I see. We missed you.
I thank you. I missed you. Good evening, poet lovers, and welcome wherever you are this evening. My first poem is entitled, what was the name?
One Day Old Coco.
You title them. I just write them.
One Day Old Coco.
One Day Old Coco. I dearly do love Coco, either with my main course or a salad. You know, I read the second line first. I think I better start
it over, yes.
Of all the winter drinks that please my fat old palate, I dearly do love cocoa, either with my main course or salad. Mm-hmm. Had to use a little...
Makes better sense.
Quiet license,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It warms my toes and whets my appetite. Even some little specks of chocolate get on my nose when I raise the cup to too great a height. Mm-hmm. But one thing that saddens me is just one day later, when I reheat my cocoa on my stove in my trusty percolator, little bits of something are swimming on the top. They look like cellophane and taste like adhesive top.
Tape.
Oh, someday in this world so fair, I hope that in the future they'll invent a machine that don't let cream turn into curdled goo, sir. Really, I really blew that one, didn't I?
Yes. Mr. Goon has one more poem. Let's see if he can bat a higher average on this one.
Construction worker. I never wanted to get in this racket in the first place.
What is the title of your next poem, Mr. Goon?
The Popsicle.
Oh, yes, Mr. Goon and The Popsicle.
He does a Dixieland show in New Orleans, I think.
Yeah.
You've heard of Popsicle?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, happy day, oh, happy day. Soon summer will be here, bringing with her warm air, green grass, and ice cream, that man so dear. In his little truck, he'll come ringing his bell of steel and brass, and in his truck, he'll be bringing goodies that to me are all first class. But of all the little treasures that please me and give me a tickle are those frosted, cold, and oh, so delicious, old-fashioned. Popsicle.
Oh.
In flavors of grape and raspberry, they chew up so nice and good. They melt and then they run down onto the shirt of every kid in the neighborhood. Oh, hurry up, dear summer, and show yourself to me so I can be a kid again and eat popsicles under a tree. I wasn't really quite sure we were going to make it this evening.
I don't think you'll win the Pulitzer Prize for these, but... Do you have a thought for the day, Mr. Goon?
Oh, I always,
yes,
yeah,
quickly.
If the snow plows come today, can spring be far away?
That's not very profound.
No, it's not. It's timely, though.
I see.
It's snowing outside.
Thank you, Randolph W. Goon. And join us once again next week for
Thank
another
you, Randolph W. Announcer.
River Anthology.
Dodge Dart is on target in Washington. Your Dodge dealer will not be undersold on the new Dodge Dart. Drive it today.
Ladies and gentlemen, our WRC microphone is in the very fashionable residential exclusive fringe area home of Mr. Harry Hollenquist. Mr. Hollenquist.
Good evening, sir.
Welcome to our WRC microphone.
Thank you, Claire. Glad to have you with us.
Pleasure to be able to come into your home with our microphone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mr. Hollenquist.
Yes, sir?
I understand you have a very unusual hobby. Is that right?
Well, it's not really too unusual. I guess you might call it that, though. I buy a new car every 6 months.
Are you a salesman? You don't use a car that often?
No, just to drive to and from work and pleasure driving on a weekend, a little summer vacation, that's
you
all.
You do enjoy new cars.
I love new cars. There's something about the smell of a new car that you just can't duplicate. When the smell wears off, nobody's been able to bottle it yet, then I just feel it's time to get a new car.
That might be a good title for a book.
What's that?
When the smell wears off.
I see, yes. Uh-huh.
Mr. Hollenquist, one thing that's always bothered me about buying a brand new car is the trouble of breaking it in. And the one thing that's even worse than that for me is the fact that it seems like every time I get a new car, within 2 or 3 months, I'm very careful with it. I'm extra cautious.
This happens to lots of people, but I have beaten the game. I have a do-it-yourself system that's guaranteed to keep you from having accidents with new cars.
But you know, every time I buy a new car, somebody always either scratches the door in a parking lot or dents up the fender.
That's the point. That's what I'm getting at.
Always somebody hits me, and usually they've got an old car, but they always do something just to nick it and make it look bad and marred surface.
Believe me, Mr. Scott, with my system, this will never happen to you again. I've been
You're
buying new cars.
You're not frustrated about this at all?
No, I've been buying new cars every 6 months for the last 15 years. I have yet to have anybody run into my car, scratch it, dent a fender, do anything that is going to mar the beauty of my car, and I sell it 6 months later and get top price for it.
When was the last time you bought a car?
Just this morning, as a matter of fact. I have a brand new, beautiful 1960 automobile.
Don't mention the name
of
the car.
No, I wouldn't do that. I know we're on the air.
Okay.
And it's right outside the house. If you just come with me here, you can see it parked right out front, right down these steps.
Yes, sir. Now, what do you do to this car to protect it from being beat up and scratched and run into by other cars?
Well, I have a foolproof system. First of all, I just do this here.
You picked up a sledgehammer and knocked the right headlight out of the car.
That's right. And then I just go over here and take the same hammer, walk over to the hood of the car, and gently... There. That's good.
But you took a sledgehammer and you completely dented the hood of the car. I don't quite understand it.
Well, you see, when I have a dent in the car and a broken headlight, the people driving down the street see me and they say, oh, that poor guy's got a brand new car and he's got a couple of little scratches on him. We better be careful. We don't want to hurt him. We don't want to hit the car. And they go out of their way to be nice and give me extra room. And I never have been bumped by an oncoming motorist.
Sir?
Yes.
You called our office and ask us to come all the way down here to interview you because of this.
I think it's a pretty good system.
We brought our engineer and the equipment down here and our microphones, and you took our time from the day to come down here and interview you.
Yeah, uh-huh.
May I have the sledgehammer, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you very much. Okay. We've been talking to Mr. Harry Hollandaise, who is our special guest this afternoon. Now back to our studio.
From the land of sky blue water.
Hams is here now.
From the land of sky blue waters comes a call to flavor refreshing. Hams beer. Hams is here now. Capturing the frosty refreshment of this land of magic enchantment. Hams beer. Hams is here now.
Hams, the beer refreshing as the land of sky blue waters. Now yours to enjoy. Be sure to try it. You've never tasted a beer just like Hams.
From the land of sky blue waters comes a call to flavor refreshing. Hams beer. Hams is here now.
Hams beer is here. Yours at local prices.
From the land of sky blue
The Oham Brewing Company, Baltimore, Pennsylvania.
Baltimore.
What did I say?
Baltimore,
Maryland.
They haven't moved yet. There's a big move on to get Baltimore into Pennsylvania, but Philadelphia's fighting it tooth and nail. I would suggest that...
I don't believe it.
For our Baltimore fans, don't worry. It's not happening anytime soon. But there is a move underway. I would like you to know that.
This is the Scott and Walker Show, where strange things are happening.
You're never more than 2 hours away from good music.
All right, boys, as a manager of the Daily News now, I want you to do a good job for me on this commercial. You know, we've got a new thing going here, along with the puzzle contest and the recipe contest. John McLeod, a fine boy, well-traveled man in the international travel section, has got this Guess Where contest, and I want you to tell him all about it. Will you do that?
Yes, sir.
Way?
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mr. Lion O'Type, the Irish editor of the Washington Daily News, Mr. O'Type.
Right, me boy, yes.
Thank you. Along with the recipe contest and the fascinating puzzle game, the Washington Daily News is offering a completely different contest, specially designed for travel enthusiasts.
Fine, you're doing a fine job.
Mr. McLeod is the fellow in charge. The Daily News' travel section has an educational Guess Where contest right now in progress. This fun contest will bring excitement to the whole family. Junior can contribute geography. Dad's maps will be very handy, and Mom's dreams of exotic countries all go together in helping your family win this contest. So be sure to get your copy of today's news and test your travel knowledge, right?
I think it's a fine job you did on that commercial, my boy.
Thank you very much.
I just developed that Irish accent. Too.
too. I want you to know that. Oh,
excuse me, sir.
Yes, all right.
Hello. Yeah, oh, Mr. McLeod, certainly. Long distance?
For me, huh?
Is the Mr. McLeod calling?
Hello,
Mr.
John. How are you, me boy? You're what? I don't believe it. I don't believe it.
Mr. O'Type, what happened to Mr. McLeod?
He's supposed to know how to travel and save money. He's broke. I got to send him a check right away. Go ahead, do the tags in the commercial.
Don't forget, too, the new idea in want advertising, as far as the want advertising is concerned in the Washington Daily News. A wonderful, new, exciting person-to-person want ad. One line for 6 days, only $1.50. Offered exclusively by the Washington Daily News, and that's the commercial, and that's it. Ladies and gentlemen, we... An icy freeze and dimpled knees. And here comes the girl wearing her BVDs, stepping out of her glass booth here at Radio Central. Miss Janitor, you tripped over the microphone cable again.
It's pretty obvious, I know that.
Help you out, honey.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, we're a little late tonight, folks, so...
Yes.
Miss Janitor, what are the Washington area temperatures for this evening?
A good book. An easy chair. A roaring fire. Your television set. Your hi-fi set. Some good records. Those you love.
All right.
And a nice...
Helena, would you mind telling us, what are you driving towards?
These are all the things you should have in your home on a cold winter's night like tonight.
Yeah.
So that you'll be comfortable.
In other words, you're saying stay home.
Yes, if you should get snowbound, why? Just relax and enjoy... Home, sweet home.
We've just been snowbound by having you on this program.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Janitor. Mm-hmm. Be careful leaving, please. Okay. Oh, my heavens.
Chase electrons to and fro. We are the joy boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
That's the Joy Boy show for this Wednesday evening. Hope you enjoyed it. We'll be back again tomorrow at 7:05. Till then, this is Ed Walker.
Willard Scott saying thank you so much for listening. Don't forget to listen to Ed Walker again tomorrow afternoon at 2 o'clock and Willard Scott tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock.
Yeah.
Bobby Shenton. Telephone tonight at 10:30, calling New York.
We are the joy boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro. We are the joy boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
Ask the man who wears one tonight flips his lid on the NBC radio network.
Miss your ma.
That's your aunt, Pa.
Just a sitting here chewing my fingernails sure ain't nothing to do tonight, is there?
No, the television blew out the picture tube this morning. I don't know what to do about it.
Can't watch none of my favorite westerns.
Had to send the piano back to the Shucks Company the other day. The old pressure board just give way on the back, you know.
Ma, what about the old wind-up Victrola? Maybe we could play some old records.
I lost the crank when we moved, Pa. Can't use it.
I gained a crank when I got married to you, Ma.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Just nothing to do, Pa. The mildew got into my old maid cards downstairs. Can't even play that this evening.
Just nothing to do. Wait a minute, Ma.
What's that?
Ain't we got a radio somewheres?
Oh, an old battery radio. Yeah, last time we used it was for the Coolidge inaugural, Ma.
Let's see. Here it is, Ma, over here under the shelf. Let me...
I forgot all about that, for goodness sake. Here, let's look at the newspaper and see what's on the radio here.
Just checking the Gordon Hittenmark show's on in the morning.
Oh, that paper's 20 years old.
Oh, hey, here's this morning's Times Dispatch News Herald Tribune. Let me... What time is it, Ma?
7:05.
7:05, old WRC.
That's a good station.
The Joy Boys, says Walker and Scott.
I don't think you want to hear them, Paul. I was overhearing on the party line how bad they are on the radio. I guess there's just no hope left, Paul.
Well, here, give me that radio.
Yeah, okay.
Joy boys of radio, we chase electrons to and fro. We are the joy boys of radio, we chase electrons to and fro.
It's time for the Joy Boys show for this Friday evening. This is Ed Walker.
Willard Scott over here of long standing.
Long standing, yeah, that was a famous old tribe. I know them well.
Bobby Shedden, our recording engineer. Long squatting. He's been squatting over there in the corner for about a half an hour. They took his chair away. I think they're trying to tell him something. They did to repair it. He needs new mohair on his bottom. We have little old Arthur Page up there.
Yeah.
Promise her anything but give her...
Art Page.
You know, we just realized we have a guy by the name of Lavan upstairs who works in the accounting department. In fact, he's in charge of it. In fact, he's right next to the manager upstairs. Very small office. But Mr. Lavan, of course, is the famous name. And
I think it's called Lavan, really, but...
Well, we take a little poetic license, Suze.
Between that and Art Page, why, we have...
The place really smells good around here. Coming up on our program, Edward... Two lawsuits and a couple of threats and one bombing. We had a writing on the note here this morning. But actually, we're going to have a very special guest today. Would you like to tell him about that?
A little later on in our program, we're going to have that master of music, Mr. Mitch Miller. How's that for alliteration, huh?
Pretty bad.
Yeah.
Actually, Mitch Miller will be here in person. Neither one of us are trying to imitate him. Mitch Miller will be our special guest in a few minutes. Also, El Ropo and his famous Gypsy dancers. The hottest team in flamenco dancing will be along later on.
And we'll have Mr. Fixit here, too.
Mm-hmm. A little public service announcement.
Oh, we got a little public service announcement. Mm-hmm. Good.
The Carroll County Cat and Kitten Counters commence counting cats and kittens this coming census. If you're contemplating becoming a Carroll County Cat and Kitten Counter, contact the Chief Cat and Kitten Counter, Charles Cullingcorn Kester, at the Carroll County Cat and Kitten Counting Center.
Cool.
The O'Ham Brewing Company, Baltimore, Maryland.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're speaking to you from a recording studio where you're about to hear the actual sounds of a recording session in progress. We're in the studios of Columbia Records in New York City where Mitch Miller is about to record another in his famous sing-along series. This album is titled March the 11th, Sing Along with Mitch. The reason for that is that these albums are so popular that he has to record a new one every day. And now I see that Mitch Miller is just about to give the instructions to the chorus. Now let's listen.
All right. Gentlemen, now when the harmonica starts, I want to hear ba-da-dee-da-da, ba-da-da-dee-da. I want that accent on the offbeat so we get that 1920 feel, you know, when they dance around and bobble their hind ends, you know, the way
yes,
they used to.
Right.
Okay, fellas?
Right, right. Okay.
All right, then we'll come in on baby face. You've got the cutest little, so we get that sort of walk with a shuffle. Ready?
Right. Okay.
Okay, harmonica, accordion. Everybody, Yuke, ready?
Well, Mr. Miller.
Yes?
This is the control room, sir. We're standing by the tape. This is CO recording 1712-R2. Take one.
Quiet, please. Quiet. All right. Here we go. Cut. What's going on here? What's the fellas? I don't... We had this all rehearsed, and we got the 25 of the best singers in America. What's going on
I'm
here?
I'm sorry, Mr. Miller.
Sorry, Mr. Miller.
Standing over in the corner, and I'm the night janitor here, and I'm very fond of your community singing, and I just couldn't restrain myself.
Well, that's all right, dear boy, but, you know, I have to get this record out for tomorrow. I have to make a new album every day. These are so popular. Yeah. And how about your pal over there? What's his reason?
Well, gee, Mr. Muller, me too. I am a very big fan of the sing-alongs, and I used to be in a barbershop group a couple of years ago, and every time I hear that music, I gotta go sing, you know? I like to sing and dance.
Well, I'll tell you what, fellas, you know, about four blocks down the street, in fact, six blocks down the street, is an RCA Victor studio. Why don't you go down there? They're doing a session, and try to sneak in on that one and sing along there. How about it?
Well, okay, Mr.
Could you give us a note of recommendation?
I'll be very happy to. Here it is.
Gee, thanks a lot, Mr. Miller.
Oh, you're very welcome.
That.
Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.
Yes. Goodbye, gentlemen.
Goodbye.
Gosh, I hated to do that to Fred and his pal. You know, they're such nice guys, you know, they sweep the studio great and they bring the coffee and everything. But, you know, business is business. I wonder, fellas, what do you think's going on down at the RCA Victor studio now? And here, folks, is how that first track on the album sounded after we got rid of our two dear friends.
Hi, I'm David Ladd. Me and my big yellow friend here will be seeing you in Dog of Flanders.
One of the most exciting motion pictures in a long, long time, A Dog of Flanders, a very exciting picture, and you can see it at your neighborhood theater. It started yesterday, and believe me, if you want to see a fine motion picture, you want to go see Dog of Flanders, right? That's right, Flanders, so thanks a lot, and lots of laughs there all the way. The gay costumes, the color, the fire, the romance, the famous flamenco guitar. Ladies and gentlemen, we have with us in our studio one of the world's greatest gypsy dancers, flamenco guitars, and flamenco dancers. His name is El Ropo, and he's brought his famous troupe of gypsy dancers and guitarists in our studio from a very successful trip just recently, a weekend at beautiful Cumberland, Maryland, nestled in the foothills of the Appalachian Mountains, where they were there on relief. El Ropo, welcome.
Hey. Thank you very much, senor. Greetings, buenas noches, señores y señores, señoritas, and the señores.
I think that includes everybody except the Boy Scout troop number 13 over in Rockville.
See, yeah, we don't want to leave nobody out.
Okay, say it to them, too.
Buenas noches, Boy Scout troop number 13 in Rockville.
El Ropo, how long have you been flamencoing?
And we've been flamencoing with the same group for the last 8 years.
And, of course, you are real masters of your art.
See, we are known as the hottest act in show business.
Well, that is the card that was handed me. It said that you are the hottest act in show business and that you've appeared in various groups of theaters all over the country.
See, we made personal appearances all over the world. We've been on television, on radio, and also on the stage.
Well, why is your act so hot? What do you do so sensational?
Of course, the movement in the flamenco dancing is very frantic, and the guitar players play so fast and so furiously that it generates, what you might say, a heat, and everybody gets excited, and when they hear these dances, they can't help themselves.
It is the most fiery and colorful of all dances, right?
I think so. See, it loses something on the radio because you cannot see the dancers, of course, but I think that the sound will create the proper mood.
Oh, all right, El Ropo, would you like to demonstrate with your group? Are they ready over there?
Sí, I think so.
Ready?
Sí. All right, thank you very much. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to perform for you a wonderful dance. This is called the double passe doble to the left andante cantabile. Waltz. Ready?
Hey, 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 hey! Like this. Just a moment. What is that noise, senor?
Apparently, the fire alarm has gone off here in the studio. in the building. I think something is on fire in the building.
Oh, see, I've been telling Pedro for this last 2 or 3 weeks he should have that electric guitar fixed. He's got a short circuit in the electric wire.
Well, apparently the flames are leaping up around the control room now.
I think you better call the fire department.
I don't think it's necessary. I think they're well on their way here. You truly are the hottest act in show business.
That's what I told you before.
Well, it's been our pleasure. We better get out of here before we get suffocated with the smoke.
Hey, you got any marshmallows?
I tell your guitar player to quit playing.
Oh, he doesn't quit. He works on union scale and he's got to play no matter what. I say, you got any marshmallows?
Yeah, we got some marshmallows in the control room.
Good. That way it won't be a total loss.
Okay, let's get out of here.
See.
Hits the bullseye in Washington. New Dodge Dart. Priced with the lowest right now at your nearest Dodge dealer. Drive it today.
WRC Radio, in cooperation with Johnson & Swanson, the world's greatest manufacturers of first aid kits, brings you another visit with Mr. Fixit, radio's original do-it-yourself program. Today, as we join Mr. Fixit, we find him in his basement working shop, where we find him working on his bench over there. What he's doing on the bench. Ahoy there, Mr. Fixit.
Hi, vey there, Willard Scott, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's good to be with you again.
Mr. Fixit, St. Patrick's Day will be here soon.
Hey, that's right, next week.
Top of the evening, Zoo.
Faith and Begory in the bottom of the afternoon to you.
Thank you very much, there.
Little witticism there.
Very bad, Mr. Fixit. Would you like to tell us what you've got up your sleeve besides your hairy old elbow today?
Maybe you've heard the old proverb, if you build a better mousetrap, people will beat a path to your door.
I've heard that old proverb, Mr. Fixit.
Good.
Did you say that originally?
Or? No, that was in one of the old books years ago, and I happened to come across this the other day, and I decided maybe that guy has got something there.
And what did you do, Mr. Fixit?
I decided to build a better mousetrap.
Would you like to explain to us what you've done and how you've accomplished this?
Certainly. Now, there have been many types of mousetraps built over the years, and I have found that the most successful of all mousetraps is a cat.
A cat, Mr. Fixit.
You've heard of the old game of cat and mouse.
Trap.
Yes, because cats love to trap mice.
Wonderful.
And so I decided that I am going to raise myself one of the finest cats that ever chased a mouse, and that's just exactly what I've done.
I assume that the cat is inside this box over here.
That's right. This is sort of the unveiling, you might say. Nobody's seen this cat. I've been feeding him on a special formula that I have developed of milk and a few other vitamins and minerals there.
People can have a copy of it after the show if they'd
certainly
like to send $1,000 to Catbird, NBC, Washington.
That's right. When I first got this cat, he was just a little fella, just a few days old, and I've been feeding him on this special formula for the last 3 months, so he should be just about ready for his first mouse escapade.
Wonderful. And this cat is designed specifically to catch nothing but mice.
Nothing but mice. Now then, if you'll walk right over here with me.
All right, sir.
Notice I've got him in this little box now.
Yes, sir.
All I do is open up the mouse and we let you see the cat.
Open up the mouse?
I mean, open up the box is what I meant to say.
Close your mouse, Mr. Fixit.
That's right. And you'll see the cat for the first time.
Okay.
Here we go. There we are, Tabby. Come on out here, little fella.
Mr. Mr. Fixit, I think somebody took you in.
I think so.
Somebody gave you
watch
the
your
wrong
pants leg there, Scotty. He's after
somebody
you.
Somebody gave you a bum lion, Mr. Fixit, because this is a cat, of course, but it's a tiger, and I think the thing is growing up into a mammoth size.
I think you're right.
We've been visiting with radio's original do-it-yourselfer, Mr. Fixit, brought to you by Johnson & Swanson, the world's foremost manufacturer of first aid kits. Be listening again next week when you'll hear Mr. Fixit say,
ouch! Help.
My name is Fearless Phil Lustine, and I'm not afraid of nobody. Get me?
Fearless Phil Lustine is so sure his deal is best, it's backed up with a $100 reward.
Yeah, that's me, Fearless Phil Lustine. I'm not afraid of nobody.
If you beat Lustine's deal on a Chevy or Corvair, this weekend, discount sale at Lustine Chevrolet of Hyattsville.
That's me, Fearless Phil Lustine. I'm not afraid of nobody.
He's open every day and open on Sunday.
Right.
Who are you?
Fearless Phil Lustine. I'm not afraid of nobody.
Boo!
I'm getting out of here.
Joy boys of radio, we chase electrons to and fro.
We are the joy boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
That's the Joy Boys show for this Friday. I want to thank Mitch Miller for being our very special guest. This is Ed Walker.
Willard Scott here. I want to thank our producer, Gersten Keks. Our director, Sigmund Freud. And our writer, Orville Wright.
Good high hell.
Bobby Shedden and Arthur Page all made this program possible. They managed to preserve the steep.
We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro. We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
Tonight on the Cavalcade of Sports, bam, bam, oh, wow, look out, boom. Ladies and gentlemen, we take you now to the Naval Observatory, where a group of scientists are sitting around discussing the recent eclipse, the total eclipse of the moon, which took place this past Saturday. First of all, Dr. Brockendorf is talking about the eclipse.
It was the most interesting thing to see. At one moment, it was a beautiful full moon. And in just the moment it takes to look into the microscope, the telescope, the moon had totally eclipsed, and I was overwhelmed by the vast nothingness, the space into which there was nothing visible for thousands of miles.
It was a very interesting observation to see the moon, first of all in the yellow of the moon, and then all of a sudden it turned into complete nothing. I saw the shadow was completely nothing around the moon. It was nothing.
Well, I wouldn't know about that, gentlemen. I was unfortunately unable to notice these total eclipse this time.
Where were you, Charlie?
Well, I was in my office listening to old tapes of the Scott and Walker show from last week, and you talk about nothingness. Ach, du lieber, my lusty friend.
Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro. We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
It's time for the Joy Boys for Monday evening. This is Ed Walker here.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Willard Scott.
Well, come off it now. Really, I don't think that's at all necessary.
Well, I want to give the show a little class, and besides...
Yourself a little class.
I'm going to borrow some money from the bank, and I want it to be well known.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bobby Shenton.
Bobby, ladies and gentlemen, in case you didn't know, is our recording supervisor. And little Arthur Page, standing over there in the corner...
Biggest man you'll ever see, nothing.
Is our recording engineer, and he's engineered better things in his day, but like his vacation last year, he got 2 months. How he injured that, we'll never know.
The judge took care of it for me.
Well, we're all set for a big, exciting Monday, ladies and gentlemen. It's a wonderful day for us all to be alive, and spring is just around the corner. Hello, spring.
Hey!
It's right around the corner, and it'll be here soon.
It's waiting for something. I don't know.
We have an award, Edward.
Hey, we have an award, Willard?
Yes, sir. The National Association of Seedless Prunes have just voted this program the biggest pit in radio.
I like that.
I don't know what it means, but it sounds crazy. It
means it's time for music.
Coming up on the show, we're going to interview a couple of old vaudevillians. Hoof and Mouth is the name of the team. They've been doing exciting work for years. Also, Arthur Codfish, and a roundtable discussion on comedy. So keep your dial set, right?
Right.
Right.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for Stars of Yesteryear. Many times in the field of show business, people are very popular, and then overnight they sort of disappear from the public eye. And today, here on the Joy Boys Show, we'd like to talk to a famous act of show business of yesteryear. We have with us in the studio the team of Hoof and Mouth, one of the finest vaudeville acts that ever trod the boards, as they say.
How do you do, Mr. Walker, Mr. Scott?
How do you do, sir? Your name is Mr.
Marty Mouth is my name.
That figures, yes. You have the mouth for it, huh?
Yes, my partner and I, good old Horace Hoof, we've been working for the past 27 years. I guess even longer than that, actually, in the vaudeville circuits. We used to tour the old Schubert circuit and the Keith circuit. And we worked in vaudeville many, many years, along with our fine pianist. Oh, say hello, Horace.
Hi. How are you?
That's Clarence, actually. Horace is over there putting on his dance shoes. Horace Hoof, as you can imagine, does the dancing, and I do the vocals to the words, and that was Clarence.
Yeah.
Clarence is our pianist. He's been with us since the Argonne Forest Battle in 1914.
You mean you met Clarence overseas in France? Is that the
during the Great War. Is that right, Clarence?
Oui, yes, oui, it was in Monsieur.
That's right. Clarence was with us in 1914 to 1959-60, he's been with us.
You might be interested, Mr. Walker, Mr. Scott. I've used the same pair of dancing shoes since we began the act in 1915, I guess it was. I've had them half-soled and new heels put on. But
these are wonderful old dancing shoes, and you fellas really toured the circuits many years ago, right?
Yes,
we did. That's right. We did many years ago.
I would very much like to hear you and see you perform, if it's within your union restrictions to do so.
I think we could, don't you, Horace?
Yes, of course. I'd be happy to. Let me just put on my shoes here.
Okay. Clarence, would you give us a little bit of the piano? You
can
see?
I play?
Yes, you'll play with us, Clarence.
Okay.
And it's a very good act, a very simple act. I mouth the words, as Marty Mouth.
You don't sing them?
No, I never sing. I just mouth the words, and Horace Hoof does the dancing.
Why don't we do a little Sheik of Araby, what do you say there, Marty?
I think that's fine. I've got the words right
here,
okay?
I got the music here.
All right, anytime you're ready.
Okay.
I'm the Sheik of Araby. Your love belongs to me. At night, dear heart, when you're asleep, into your tent, I'll creep and creep. The stars at night do shine. Above, they'll light our way. Fashion kind of love. You'll rule this land. You'll rule it with me, Premier Nasser, because I'm the Sheik of Araby. No dance sermon classier. Mr. Squat, Mr. Walker.
And you've been unemployed for how many years?
Since 1928. The crash hit us a year before it hit the rest of the country, and we were in bad shape.
It figures.
The tom-toms echoing tell you of sky blue waters rippling coolly by you. They're singing, they're bringing cool refreshment to you. From the land of sky blue waters comes a call to flavor refreshing.
Yes, the one and only Ham's Beer is here, bringing you flavor crisp as a northern breeze. Clean cut and refreshing as pine-scented air.
From the land of sky blue waters comes a call to flavor refreshing. Ham's Beer, refreshing Ham's Beer.
Ham's Beer is here, yours at local prices.
From the land of
okay, kid, now you're a new announcer in the station here. All you have to say is Theo Ham Brewing Company, Baltimore, Maryland.
Okay.
Here's the copy.
Theo Brew Hamming Company, Baltimore, Maryland.
No.
Hamo The Brewing Baltimore Company,
Theo
Maryland.
Ham.
Theo Brew Hamming Ham. Company. Now the...
We help the ladder, climb my way to heaven.
And now, Shaughnessy's Shillelaghs, the greatest name in big sticks, brings you Arthur Codfish time. And here he is, Arthur the Old Blarney Stone Codfish.
Hello, how are you?
Walter.
Let me put the old ukulele down here. Collie, it's been such a miserable couple of days. The wind has been the whistling and the snow has been... You know, down on the farm, Meatball?
I've heard the song, yes.
How you gonna keep 'em down on the farm after they've seen Rockville? Well, Collie, down on the farm, I was down there yesterday. There's a little creek that runs down below the hen house. I was down there by the creek and there's a drift 4 feet deep.
Well, that's pretty deep, isn't it all?
Collie, it was deep down by the creek yesterday. St. Patrick's Day will be along in a couple more days.
Certainly, good morning to you, Mr. Codfish.
Caramel Flynn, welcome to the program, Caramel.
Oh, my, I'm glad to be here with you again. Sure, and I am that.
How's the fine little lady this morning?
Wonderful, Mr. Codfish, all ready for my annual St. Patrick's Day concert in one of the big halls up here in New York.
Collie, I'm so glad to hear you're going to sing
Schwartz's
again.
Schwartz's Pool Hall is where I'm doing it this year, Arthur.
You're going to really belt out a couple of fine old songs from the old side.
Yes, I am. I'd like to sing one for you now, if you don't
mind. My father gave me a shillelagh once when I was about 8 years old.
Is that right, Arthur?
Right over the back of the neck. Give you a shillelagh right across your big fat head in a second, Meatball. Come on over here, honey.
Certainly, Mr. Codfish.
Caramel, you look so pretty today.
Thank you, no.
You look so pretty.
Oh, I bet you tell that to all the girls.
Kelly, you look so pretty. Meatball, you're looking kind of pretty yourself.
Well, thank you, Walter, very much, Walter.
Caramel, what are you going to sing for our good folks on St. Patrick's Day?
Well, I'd like to sing that old favorite, me Wild Irish Rose, if the band knows it.
Let's hear it, girl. Sing a little bit of Irish music for us. Good Irish music from a good Irish lass.
Thank you now, thank you.
Come along now, girl.
Me wild Irish rose, the sweetest flower that grows. You may search everywhere, but none can compare to me wild Irish rose.
Caramel, I think you've been in the Irish whiskey there. I wouldn't
wild
swear to it, my girl.
Irish rose,
I think you've been tapping the Irish cider jug, if it's all right. Meatball, will you mind walking her out
certainly
of the studio?
Come along, Carmel.
I don't understand it. I was just...
We'd better get along. Shillelaghs from the wonderful old country. Here we go again. So long, folks. Diddle-di-diddle-di-diddle-di-diddle-di. Wonder where she hid that stuff. Must be around here somewhere.
It's fantastic. The Luck of the Irish is yours Thursday, Friday, and Saturday at the grand opening celebration of Hampshire Langley. Corner New Hampshire Avenue and University Boulevard, Langley Park, Maryland.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're speaking to you from the seminar room of Mouth Washington University as the National Broadcasting Company presents another exciting radio forum. Today's topic, modern comedy. We have seated around the forum table now Mr. Christopher Kraft of Mouth Washington University, Professor of Speech.
Thank you very much, sir.
Also, Mr. Good Aceman, who is from the Tempest Fugit University.
Oh, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here on the board forum.
And finally, the noted comic and modern television performer, Mr. Jack Pott. Mr. Pott.
Thank you very much. How's the kid, huh?
First of all, to start this forum this afternoon, Mr. Chester Kraft, or Christopher Kraft, pardon me, Professor.
Yes, Kraft. Christopher Kraft is my name.
Start the discussion, please.
Certainly. I have been a student and interested in comedy for many years, and I've taught it in many courses here at the Mouth Washington University. And there's a great evolution, you might even say a metamorphosis in comedy, since the early days of vaudeville.
What does metamorphosis mean? I was just out to get
you
that.
You lunkhead, that means a complete change, turnabout. You might say. That is too big a word for a writer of your caliber, I'm
sure. In other words, you're stating that comedy has changed. No longer today do they have the slapstick, pie-throwing, punching-in-the-mouth type comedy.
No, they don't need that. I mean, after all, fellas, let's be realistic about it nowadays. The audience is more sophisticated today. They don't want to go out there and see somebody get popped in the face with a pie. No, sir. They want some clever humor. They want to be told jokes that are going to make them sit up and take notice. The kind of things you got to sit there and listen and watch for the material, you know.
In other words, you're saying that some comedy today is going back to the Shakespearean days of comedy when a comedy was very closely related to tragedy, and the laughs that were obtained from a tragic situation.
You might say that, yes. They call them sick comics, I suppose.
A sick comedian today rules the world.
Yes, well, you're a top-notch writer. Have you had any trouble adjusting yourself to the material that these comics are requiring today?
Well, as an old satirist from way back, some people call me that, other people call me other things, but as an old satirist, I have found quite difficult to adjust to modern-day sick comedy writing.
I noticed that. The only writing you've been doing lately is applications for jobs.
I've been out of work for 2 months, and it's a little embarrassing, but
only kidding.
I'm not a sick comic. Yeah, well, that's... I think, Mr. Pott, you're more of a sick comic than we are.
I beg your pardon. I feel perfectly all right. I've never felt better in my life. Oh,
the
sick
style
comic,
of comedy that today is in the world.
Well, I don't know if you'd call it sick comedy or not, but here's one of my favorite stories I'd like to give
you an example for us.
Yes, this goes over real big down in Miami when
I play.
Is
this supposed to be a funny gag?
And this is a riot. Now, you just listen closely.
A modern
now.
Gag.
Yeah. Now, you watch for the punchline here. You ready?
Does it belt you in the mouth, or is it a
It really does. It's got a lot of laughs there. These two guys are walking down the road, see? One guy says, oh, look out, Logan, watch out for that cliff. And the other guy says, what cliff? Did you get it?
I think it's a pretty bad joke myself.
It didn't do a thing for me.
I mean, it's so sick, it's
way out. And I understand it. The guy was saying he didn't see the cliff, you know, and he says, what cliff? And he
before, now, I got the intonation of the joke, but the humor ceases to amuse me. I see nothing funny about it. It's a bomb.
I beg your pardon?
It's a bomb joke.
Nobody says anything about my material like that and gets away with
it.
Look,
the gag, it just hasn't got
writers
it.
Like you are 10 cents a dozen, believe me.
Well, I'm not sorry about that, but the point is that the joke you just told is a bomb joke. And
you don't like my joke?
Person.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've been attending a special seminar on modern-day comedy. Our special guest today, Mr. Christopher Kraft of Mouth Washington University.
Yes.
Mr. Good Aceman, who represents the Tempest Fugit University.
Ah, my teeth are back in my mouth.
And finally, Mr. Jack Pott, noted modern TV comic.
I skin my knuckles up there. You got a Band-Aid, pal?
Back to our studio.
Ah, well, now, me boys. It's good to see you again here. My, oh, my, oh, my, what a wonderful night it is, huh?
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mr. Linotype, who is the managing editor of the Washington Daily News.
Right. That's right.
Mr. O'Type.
Good afternoon. I should say good evening. Only a couple of days away from St. Patrick's Day, and I've got a terrible problem with the paper.
I notice all your cufflinks are green and your tie is green. You'll probably have a completely green suit on by St. Patrick's
Day. I'm working on it. I wanted them to turn off the presses, and we all get down to Kerrigan's on St. Patrick's Day, and, you know, and we'll have a few there, and but they won't.
The newspaper people have to print their paper every day, as they've done for years, and they didn't want to leave the press.
That's right. Well, you know, I come down here to say it's another bright Monday that dawned today for all of the fans of the Washington Daily News puzzle contest. You know, it was just 2 weeks ago, me boy, that the winning solution was hit for puzzle pay dirt of over $1,500, and believe me, I felt every penny of it.
Big money, huh?
Oh, you know it.
Got you close to your heart, near your wallet.
Right where my wallet was, yes, sir. This is a wonderful game, this puzzle contest, you know. It's in full swing again now. Aye, that it is now. And the jackpot is $249.50.
$249.50?
Aye, that's just exactly what I said, yes.
I guess if you aren't already a regular puzzle devotee, we think that you'll want to get in on this popular contest right now, right?
I definitely think you should. Of course you should, no.
Puzzles are really prize puzzles, and the prize, as you can see, is mighty profitable.
Oh, my, yes.
Puzzles appear each Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday in the Washington Daily News, and you just complete and send in a solution for each day's puzzle, and as easy as that, you're in the running for the new jackpot.
That's right. So why don't you all join in the fun and be sure to get your copy of the news. The first puzzle contest of this week is in there, you know. That's in today's issue of the Washington Daily News, Washington's modern newspaper, and you got something else to tell them at the bottom of the script.
Well, they have a wonderful new feature called Person to Person
That
for
they do.
Profit. Person to Person want ads give you one line for 6 days for a low $1.50, that's all.
Well, I better go back down and mind the paper, you know. Thank you,
okay,
boys.
Mr. Linotype, the managing editor.
You know, we'll be seeing you.
Speak person to person exclusively in the Washington Daily News.
They'll always be in Ireland.
Okay, see you there.
Hello, chase electrons to and fro. We are the joy boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
Well, that just about does it for the Monday edition of the Joy Boys. Till tomorrow, then, this is Ed Walker.
Leonard Scott thanking Bobby Shedden, Arthur Page, and all the folks who made tonight's program possible. We'll see you again tomorrow, 7:05, all things being equal.
Mm-hmm, yeah. And we'll look for you.
We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro. We are the Joy Boys of radio. We chase electrons to and fro.
Horatio Hornblower goes on a big toot tonight on the NBC Radio Network.
Topsy-turvy.
WRC, WRC-FM, NBC in Washington.